Thank you very much. And so, thank you very much to the organizers, because it's really a great pleasure for me to speak at this conference in honor of Arthur August. We met, I think, for the first time in 1974, and we were working on crystalline cohomology from the very beginning. And now I am returning to crystalline cohomology again, so I think it's perhaps an appropriate circumstance to talk about this. Nevertheless, it's not a completely new work by far, and I have to apologize to those who have heard earlier versions of this talk. With respect to Montpellier, where I gave a talk at the Grothendieck conference last June, this is the same talk, except that now there are slides. And that's partly a result of Arthur's insistence for me to write down completely these results, which I have not finished to do, but at least that's a way of showing that I take his advice seriously. Okay, so I want to talk about crystalline cohomology mod P to the N, and to try to give more general finiteness results than those which are classically known. So the notation for the introduction will be the usual notations. P is a prime number, N is an integer, we will be working mod P to the N. K will be a perfect field of characteristic P, and W, Wn, the read of it vectors of length N with coefficients in K. So we have crystalline cohomology for proper and smooth varieties over K with respect to Wn, and it's a good cohomology. That for us will mean three things. First, that it's isomorphic with the Durham cohomology of a smooth lifting when there exists such a lifting. Second, that the complex of crystalline cohomology, the derived sense, is a perfect complex of Wn modules. And third, that it satisfies Poincaré duality. So this is how you will find things in literature. And there are some of these results, maybe most all of these results, which can be generalized to locally free finitely generated crystals on the crystalline site of X0. But beyond this, there is essentially nothing about finiteness or perfection or Poincaré duality for more general coefficients. So I want to introduce bigger category of coefficients relative to Wn, for which I will have similar results to 0.123, which I just quoted. And I want, in particular, whenever it's possible, relative versions of the finiteness properties. Now, I say whenever it's possible, but I should perhaps put a flat here, because we do not expect to have a full formalism of Grothendieck 6 operations when we work with torsion coefficients, because we know that crystalline cohomology, as is defined, is not working properly over non-smooth or non-proper schemes. And also, from arithmetic D-module theory, there are some problems with Frobenius pullback, which require to work with more general sheaves of differential operators. So I won't enter into that here, but I will limit myself to the classical crystalline setup. So what are the results that I can give today? I assume that X0 is a smooth K scheme, and S will be spec Wn, OX0 over S, the structural sheaf of the crystalline site, which will be the nilpotent crystalline site today. And I will construct two triangulated categories of filtered complex of OX0 modules, which I call D-perfect and D-chesh-perfect, which have the following properties. If you assume that X is liftable, then these categories are respectively equivalent and anti-equivalent to the category of perfect complexes of D-module. D is the ring of PD differential operators, as defined in Berthelot-August, for example, which I'm sometimes denoted by D0 in arithmetic D-module theory. Now, these two categories are exchanged by a local biduality theorem. That's O duality. We'll return to that later, of course. Third, they have a singular support in the cotangent space, as have the coherent D modules. And we can define the notion of non-characteristic morphism between two smooth schemes with respect to a complex given either on X0 or on Y0. And when we make non-characteristic assumptions, then we can have some finiteness results, like finiteness or Poincaré duality theorems. So as I said, I will be working with a PD nilpotent crystalline site because I really need to be able to associate a crystal, a filtered crystal, to any filtered D-module. I expect that similar results should be true for sheaves on the usual crystalline site, which would then allow to include the case P equal 2. But it's more complicated because there is the nilpotency condition to handle in the case of the usual crystalline site, and that I have not completely clarified yet. Also, the theory will apply to the log scheme context. In particular, if you endow S with a Yudokato log structure, then you can have, and if you assume that the log scheme satisfies an additional complex for the higher differential sheaf, to be able to apply duality, then you have the same results for log schemes.
What's the Yudokato log structure?
The Yudokato log structure is the pullback, you pull back from the ring of vid vectors to K, and then you go to Wn of K by the Teich-Müller map. This gives you the log structure. Right? So let me define now D perfection. So I consider a more general situation than in the introduction. I have a scheme X0 over, no, S0 goes to S is a PD immersion defined by a PD nilpotent ideal. S is annihilated by the power P to the N that I mentioned in the introduction. And X0 will be a smooth S0 scheme of relative dimension D or DX, generally DX. And sometimes I assume X to be liftable, so then I know X0 to be liftable, then I note by X the lifting of X0. DX will be the sheaf of PD differential operators over X in all the talk. So assume first that the smooth lifting is given. X.
One slide, I'm sorry.
Yeah, sure.
X is now, of course, now it's relative.
So classically, one has a functor, which I will denote in this talk by Cx0, from left dx modules to crystals of Ox, to Ox0 over S module first, which is, I'll briefly recall how it's defined. If you take a thickening the crystalline site, then it's a nilpotent immersion. So as X is smooth over S, you can extend the given map from U to X, to as a map H, say, from T to X. This map is not unique, but the pullback is in fact well-defined up to canonical isomorphisms thanks to the Taylor formula. And you can glue when you let the thickening vary in the crystalline site, and this defines the sheaf of OX0 over S modules. And the most basic, perhaps, result when you start with crystalline cohomology is that this is an equivalence of categories between the category of DX modules and the category of crystals, which itself is a subcategory of OX0 over S module. However, you should... Oh, sorry. I'm going too fast. You should pay attention to the fact that CX0 is not an exact functor, even though you begin by an equivalence of categories, which means that the inclusion of crystals into OX0 over S modules is not an exact functor itself. This is because you define CX0 by pulling back by the local functor H upper star, which are tensor products and which are not flat in general.
Can you remind me, so the category of crystals is an abelian category?
Yes, because it's equivalent to LFDX modules. But the kernel is not the same in the category of crystals and the category of OX0 over S module. For example, the kernel of P is not a crystal, it's a sheaf. And it has also a sense in the sense of D modules. You take the D modules and the kernel of P and the D modules, but that doesn't commute with taking this CX0 functor. So, sorry for the reference, which is not good. I want the derived category of the previous proposition. So we derive CX0, and I will shift to ensure compatibility with conventions in D module theory. I will denote by CRX0, the shift from D minus 1 of DX, the functor from D minus 1 of DX to D minus 1 of OX0 over S, which is obtained by deriving the functor CX0, that is replacing any complex of D module by a flat resolution, or at least something which is a resolution by modules which are flat over OX. And then I shift by dx. This to have nicer formulas later. So first, the notation, when I have a thickening in the crystalline site on the complex of modules in the derived category. I can define the complex which is induced on the thickening T, which I will denote by E dot T. This is because the functor which associates to a module its value on the thickening T is an exact functor. So with this definition, I can define crystalline complexes as being the complexes for which the canonical transition map for any morphism of thickening from T prime to T is an isomorphism in the derived category. So this means this derived map is defined by replacing E dot, the complex E dot by flat resolution over OX0 over S, and then taking the transition map V star of this resolution over T goes to this resolution over T prime. So those complexes I will call crystalline. Note that their cohomology sheaves on the crystalline site is not in general, are not in general crystals. And classical example of such a complex, if you take a smooth morphism of schemes, x0 goes to y0, then the derived direct image of OX0 over S is a crystalline complex of y0 over S. So I want to study this functor, CR0, and I will use various subcategories of the categories of complexes of OX0 over S modules. I will denote by D minus lower Chris the full subcategories consisting of crystalline complexes. BFTD of OX0 over S will be complexes of finite third dimension, as usual. And DQC of OX0 over S mean the full subcategory of complexes which have quasi-coherent values on each thickening T. And sometimes I will collect these indexes into complicated things, but that just means I take all the intersection of all these categories. So you have properties which are easy consequences of the definition of the functor CRX0. So first of all, as I said, no, I didn't say, but this is easy to check by replacing the curly E dot by flat resolution. The complex you get is a crystalline complex. Second, it's finite third dimension over OX0 if and only if you started with a complex of D module, which is a finite third dimension over DX. And third, it's quasi-coherent if and only if the initial complex of D module was quasi-coherent. So I want to characterize the essential image of the complexes which are finite third dimensional and quasi-coherent over DX by such properties. This is my immediate goal. So to do this, I will use the fact that there is a right adjoint to the functor CX0. For I will construct this by using the projection of crystalline topos to the Zariski topos, which is traditionally denoted by UX0 over S. So it's defined, if you want, by inverse images. For each thickening, you take as a value of UX0 over S minus 1 of F, the value of F over U. So you can use this for the sheaf DX itself. DX is a bimodule, left DX module and right DX module by multiplication. So you can apply CX0 to DX, as viewed as the left DX module. And what do you get? You get something which is an OX0 over S module, and even a crystalline OX0 module by the previous construction. But you transport this action on the right, so you get also a bimodule which has a right action by the sheaf U minus 1 X0 over S of DX. So now, here is the way you can associate a DX module to an OX0 over S module. You take, first of all, the ohms over OX0 over S of this crystalline transfer bimodule CX0 of DX into your sheaf F, and then you project on the Zariski site. You get a functor which I denote by MX over F. So from its description, you see that it's right exact. So we can also derive it, and I will denote by DMX of F dot the derived functor translated by minus DX. So then, from the definition, you get easy properties. You get first that you can define for arbitrary dx modules the sheaf, the crystal d cx0 of E, just by taking the universal bimodule, transfer bimodule, and tensorizing on the right over u minus 1 of x0 over s with u minus 1 x0 over s of E. Then, using this formula, it's an exercise to see that mx is right adjoint to cx0. And you can derive this adjunction, and you have what I will refer to as the adjunction formula in the derived category sense, which of course implies an ordinary adjunction formula between CRX0 and DMX0. So what are the finiteness properties of this functor? If you assume that you start with a crystalline functor, the complex F dot, which is bounded, no, it should, well, no, doesn't matter. DMX F dot will be in DB FTD, finite order dimension of DX, if and only if you start with complex which is of finite order dimension over OX0 over S. And it will be quasi-coherent if and only if the same holds for the initial complex. So, what do I find? I find two functors, CRX0 from complexes which are bounded of finite order dimension and quasi-coherent over DX, to crystalline complex which have the same properties over OX0 over S, and conversely, DMX goes the other way. Then the theorem, first theorem in the theory is the fact that these two functors adjoint are quasi-inverse equivalents between these two categories which I just wrote. So from the adjunction formula, you get maps from the composition, and you use the computation of direct image, RU x0 over S star, by means of the Cech-Alexander complex to prove that these are isomorphism. So you find some corollaries. For example, if you have two complexes which are finite order dimension of on quasi-coherent over dx, the projection of the R-ohm over OX0 over S is the R-ohm over D. And this is in particular contains as a particular case the comparison with the RAM cohomology, because if you take you take F dot E dot equal to OX of minus DX, then the formula boils down to this one. And this is the Durham complex of the complex of D module F dot as defined in D module theory, but can be identified, of course, with the usual way of writing the Durham complex. So I come to the definition of D perfect complexes. So I will give first a local description. We will say that a complex is D perfect if there is an open covering of the scheme, and for each open subset of the covering, a smooth lifting over S and the perfect complex of D module over that lifting, such that our initial complex E dot restricted to the complex to the crystalline site of the open subset is the CR of this perfect complex. So locally, I have complex which can be identified with complexes in the essential image of the CR functor for appropriate lifting. So this seems to be dependent upon some choice of covering, but we'll see later that it's not. So a special case is bounded perfect complexes of OX0 over S modules. It's a simple exercise to check that they're actually D-perfect too. I will denote.
When you say perfect in this D, that means they have finite resolution but projective D modules?
Yes, yes. But pull back over the crystalline site of projective D modules, projective finitely generated D modules. So I will denote by DB.
So you commented about the question of dependence on the covering, but in the special case, bounded perfect complexes, in the definition of a perfect complex on any site, it's a local condition.
Yeah. So it's a local condition, but I can describe, I will give you the statement in the next slide, so we'll return to that. Okay, so I will denote by D, index D perf, the category of the full subcategory of D perfect complexes. And now here's the answer to what you said. You can have this characterization as being CRX0 of E for a perfect complex of D module for any lifting if you assume the condition is true locally. That is, you can glue. That's the point. Okay. So as a consequence, you find that the category is triangulated. And another characterization of D perfection is that you can do it relative to S0, which is of course much easier because you don't have to lift anything. If you start with something which is already assumed to be crystalline and for finite third dimension, then the D perfection condition can be restricted to S0. It's equivalent to have it with respect to S or with respect to S0.
And here S0 is defined by any PD ideal, not just by P.
Yeah, in this second section, yeah. Just a PD ideal, which is PD nilpotent.
Is this difficult to prove, this one?
That's a consequence of the full faithfulness.
What of the general assumption? Can you recall the general assumption on the streams?
So S0 is goes into S is just a PD immersion, which is defined by a PD nilpotent ideal. And X0 is a smooth S scheme, S0 scheme, and X is
a... But I think there could be potentially some small pathology in what you're explaining when things are not quasi-compact and the dimension is not constant, because when you want to manipulate globally bounded complexes, sometimes the dimension of the smooth schemes appears in some computations. So if there are many connected components, then maybe some statement on sending bounded to bounded could fail globally because of this.
Yeah, you're right. So maybe I should assume that it's separated and quasi-compact. Certainly, we always have that in mind.
But this has to be locally in the Ethereum, unfortunately, so it can't be in PD envelope.
For the time being, in the last proposition, it's locally in Ethereum. I'm not sure this is essential, in fact. But if you take PD envelopes, in any case, you will have to take truncated PD envelopes. So this, if you start to, so that doesn't cause really problems here. But yeah, maybe that can be eliminated. And I have been a little lazy. I don't know when I will write the final form of this thing. Maybe that will improve. I'm not sure.
And the prime is important. P is important.
Okay, so we have this notion of D perfection. But the first remark is that it doesn't behave so well with respect to closed immersions. What happened with closed immersion? Assume that F0 from X0 to Y0 is a closed immersion. Then you have the following description of the direct image of the structural sheaf. If you take a thickening in the crystalline site of Y0, and if you call U the intersection of V with X0, then you can view U as a closed subscheme of T defined by an ideal K. You have to take the divided power envelope of K with compatibility with gamma and delta. And then you take the PD ideal generated by K and you truncate by the nth power, divided power sense of this ideal. And you take the inverse limit. If you were in characteristic zero, this complicated thing will just be the formal completion of OT along V, along U. Oh, sorry. And of course, this is inverse limit of coherent sheaves in general, if you start with coherent with local Neferian schemes. But it's not quasi-coherent, which already showed that this cannot be a perfect complex as we defined it. So it's not a problem with the nilpotent crystalline site. Maybe I should add this remark, because if you were looking at the direct image of the crystalline, of the structural sheaf on the usual crystalline site, then the problem would be that it's defined by dx module, but this dx module is not finitely generated. It's infinite union of torsion submodules for the p-curvature filtration, if you want. So in fact, this can be explained, and we'll see later that this complex is the OX0 over S linear dual of a D perfect complex. Not D perfect, but a dual of a D perfect complex. And this is why I will have to introduce another category, which I will call dual of D perfect complexes, which I will denote by D-Chesh perfect complexes. But I don't want to lose anything when I take this linearity over OX0, it's this dual over OX0. And because the sheaves which I am working are not finitely generated over OX0 over S, I need to do something to take into account these inverse limit problems. And the choice I have made was to introduce filtration, Hodge type filtrations, and to work systematically with filtered complex. So what I mean by filtered rings and modules here is defined as in Bourbaki. That is, there is no assumption of exhaustivity or separatedness or anything on the filtration, just an abstract filtration with no particular property. And this can be used to give filtered version of the usual functors ohm and tensor product. And from this, you deduce filtered version of inverse images and so on. Basically, any functor you can think of has a filtered version. So which filtration will I be using? For OX, I will use the filtration given by the ideal which defines S0 into S, the IP-dyadic filtration, which is a discrete filtration. And for I negative, I will just take I equal OS. For the sheaf of differential operators, it has a natural filtration by the order of differential operators, which is an increasing filtration, while the previous one was decreasing. But I don't use this one because I'm working mod I. I want a theory for coefficients mod I. So I have to enlarge the filtration by making the tensor product with the filtration, the I-adic filtration coming from the base. So this is a description of the filtration for the ring of differential operators. Finally, OX0 over S has a natural p-dyadic ideal, which is the kernel of the map to the direct image of OX0 on the crystalline site. J, the map which defines UE, which defines U over into T for any thickening U into T. And I filter by the divided powers of this ideal, JX0 over S. So I will use the terminology filtered crystal, and actually this notion was introduced by August in his book on T crystals, and the same thing. That's a filtered OX0 over S module, such that for any morphism in a crystalline site, the transition morphism, usual one, is filtered isomorphism. That is, you have to take into account here the tensor product of the filtration of ET with the p-dyadic filtration on T prime. And this gives you a filtered isomorphism. So then you have an equivalence of categories between filtered left DX modules for the filtration that I described previously, and filtered crystals in this sense on OX0 over S. I think you can find this in Arthur's book. So now we have to go to derived categories, so there is a little blabla to say. It's not, the category of filtered module is not an Abelian category, but it is an exact category in the sense of Quillen. That is, you have a particular notion of short exact sequence. And this has been investigated by Laumont, who constructed the derived categories of exact categories in the sense of Quillen. And you apply this to the category of DX modules with, unfortunately, some additional assumption that I cannot use here. But the point with the general notion that I am working with is that you have enough acyclic or displayed objects to ensure the derivability of the usual functors. That is tensor product, ohm, f lower star, f upper star, and so on. And finally, with little tedious work, you can check that the definitions of pseudo-coherent complexes, finite dimensional complexes, and perfect complexes can be extended as from the exposé of Illusi in SGSIS to the context of filtered module. And the same statements remain true. So I will use this construction to derive, in the filtered sense, the functor CX0. And from now on, I will always assume that everything respects filtration. So in particular, there will be a notion, an equivalence of category between the bounded filtered complexes, which are finite dimension and are quasi-coherent over DX, to the same thing, which are crystalline, over OX0 over S. It is our previous equivalence, but now with filtrations. And without liftability assumption, we can define the category of D-perfect filtered complexes as before by the local condition that locally there exists a lifting of an open subset of X from on which your filtered complex on the crystalline site comes from the perfect filtered complex on the ring of differential operators. So to state biduality, I have to pay a price for not putting the exhaustivity condition in the definition. Now I have to introduce it. So I denote by AF, if A is a filtered ring, the union of all phil I of A. I will call these elements of finite order in A, and similarly for any filtered A module. So these are submodules over AF of E, and I can induce them with the induced filtration. So EF is a filtered AF module, and I say that A is exhaustive if AF equals E. This is the standard definition. And I apply it also for complexes, and we say that the complex is exhaustive in the canonical morphism from EF, which is an exact functor and goes to the derived category. So this canonical functor from E dot F to E dot is an isomorphism in the derived category. In particular, any D-perfect complex is exhaustive. This amounts to the fact that the ring of differential operators is itself endowed with an exhaustive filtration.
Filtered perfect, is it tested on the associated graded?
Yes, it can in some cases. You have to put the assumptions. And first of all, the filtration must be exhaustive and discrete. And maybe I've only checked when the ring is Noetherian. That can be done. Yeah, that's in fact the point that I will be using crucially later. Okay, so let me return to the biduality map. So I consider two complexes, E dot, I dot of filtered A module and the filtered ring A. So I have the traditional biduality morphism relative to I dot, which sends E dot to om dot of om dot E dot I dot into I dot. Inside this morphism, which is a filtered morphism, I have the morphism which is induced by the previous one on elements of finite order. So I just add the F on E on om. And I also have the map, which comes off by functoriality here, where I restrict the second om dot to the set of morphisms of finite order. And I'm really interested in this map as a biduality morphism. So this I will call the finite order biduality morphism for E dot relative to I dot. And that definition can be extended to the derived category to give you a map between the R ohms, biduality map between the R ohms. So I need a dualizing complex on X0 over S. So this is cheating because I've made no assumption on S. So it's really some kind of relative dualizing complex. And that's going to be just a structural shift. The structural shifted by dx for twisted by dx for the filtration and shifted by 2dx for the degree in cohomology. And then I will use the notation e dot chesh or decrease of x0 over s for the finite order morphisms of E into K. And if I have a smooth lifting, I will denote by CR chesh the composition of CR and IHES, that is the functor that I obtain by setting CR chesh x0 of E dot is CR x0 of E dot chesh. So now if I take E0 to be exhaustive, if I work in the derived category, you see that this is going to be a quasi-isomorphism, and this is my finite order biduality map, and I can invert the first map and I will get a biduality theorem, a biduality morphism from E dot to E dot chesh. So whenever E dot is an exhaustive complex. So there is a biduality theorem which says first that arm E dot, if E is D-perfect, DBF D-perfect, the complex is the dual complex is exhaustive. The dual complex in the naive sense, that without taking the F, is in fact exhaustive, hence it's isomorphic to Cech dual, and it's bounded. And then the key point is that the biduality morphisms, either for E dot or for its dual, which is still defined because I said just that the dual is exhaustive, these two biduality morphisms are isomorphisms. So you can lose nothing when you go from a complex which is D-perfect to its linear dual in this sense, which is D-Cech perfect. So I will define now formally the category of D-Cech perfect complexes by saying that locally they are, as before, for CR in the direct, in the essential image of CR-Cech. Fortunately, there is an intrinsic characterization which is more, which is not dependent upon the choice of a covering. So you have the following condition. You must require that if F dot must be exhaustive, that its dual should be D-perfect, and that the biduality morphism should be an isomorphism. So as a corollary, you get that the category of D-Cech perfect is a triangulated subcategory, and it's anti-equivalent to the category of D-perfect complexes. Okay, now let's go to the last section, comparison and finiteness theorems. So for D-perfect and D-Cech perfect complexes, we can define a singular support mimicking the construction for arithmetic D-modules, for algebraic D-modules. First of all, if you assume that X0 has a smooth lifting, the graded of DX for this modified filtration that I introduced earlier is in fact the tensor product of the graded of DX0 with the graded of OX, but the graded of OX is just OX0 plus some nilpotence. So this means that this graded of DX has a spectrum, the topological space underlying its spectrum, the Cartesian space of X0. So I will systematically identify the grade of DX with the Cartesian space on X0. Okay, then if you take the associated graded module, which you can define because it's an exact functor on the derived category of filtered complex, the sheaves of this complex, which is now a complex of objects in an abelian category, they are coherent gradX modules. So we can associate them a coherent sheaf on X0. I said coherent, but I would have said quasi-coherent here. I'm sorry. I don't need to create a coherent. So you can associate a sheaf on gradX, on spec gradX, which is a quasi-coherent sheaf, which I denote by H tilde n of grad E dot. And I view this as a sheaf on the Cartesian space T star X0. So then in this case, if I have a D-perfect complex on the crystalline site of X0, which comes from a perfect complex of D-module on DX, I will denote by SS of straight E dot the union of the supports of this quasi-coherent sheaves H tilde n of dot inside T star X0. So that doesn't depend upon the lifting, it's easy to check. And in the general case, then you can glue. And now you can also apply this to the dual by taking the singular support of the dual of F. So you have this notion of singular support from for all sheaves which are either all complexes which are either D perfect or D Cech perfect. Now I want to introduce this non-characteristic condition on morphisms. So the cotangent space has a complicated functoriality because it basically is a covariant functor. So if you have a morphism of schemes from X0 to Y0, you build first the Cartesian square over this morphism with the cotangent space over Y0. And then the functoriality map goes from is a projection from X0 cross over Y0 T star Y0 to T star X0. So this is a classical diagram that you look in D-module theory in characteristic zero. It's defined over any base. And you say that F0 is non-characteristic for a complex defined over Y0. So this is a definition for inverse images. If the projection, when restricted to the pullback, so you have for F, you have this singular support which lives in the cotangent space of Y0, you can pull back to the fiber product, and then you can project to the cotangent space of X0, and you want this projection restricted to the pullback of the singular support to be proper. And this is, for example, always satisfied when F0 is smooth. So this contains the case of inverse image by smooth morphism. Now you can give an analogous definition for a direct image, but it's not so new because it's equivalent to the fact that F restricted to the support of the complex on X0 is proper. Okay, so now I recall the definition of direct and inverse image functors for the D modules, F upper strict of F dot and F lower plus of E dot, when F dot is a complex of modules on Y, and E dot a complex of modules on X, and F over X over Y is morphism of S schemes. Then you can define, you can prove, as in characteristic zero, that you have the non-characteristic finiteness theorems for D modules. And the proof is actually essentially that which is given by Lomon in characteristic zero, except that Lomon uses the fact that the ring of differential operators has finite homological dimension. That makes things a little easier, that I have not at my disposal here. So I have to use what was my answer to Luc's question a few minutes ago. The possibility of checking perfection by taking the associated graded. And so now we want to translate these statements into statements on the crystalline site. So first, inverse images. If I have morphism of smooth F schemes, I have first a general compatibility for any complex which is bounded on D on Y. The inverse image of the CR0 of F dot is CRX0 of F upper strict of F dot up to some twist on shift, which comes from the definition of F upper strict. And if you use this and the fact that the notion of deperfection can be checked locally, then you find that if you start with a morphism which is non-characteristic for F dot, then F, the inverse image of F dot will be still be deperfect on X0. So we have similar results for discharge perfect, but I have to do something which I didn't really discuss so far, which is use the big crystalline topos to have the possibility of interpreting the ohm, which enters through duality, as a local ohm, and the inverse image at this ohm as the restriction to a subsite. So the inverse images are much nicer on the big crystalline site, and this is indeed used here. So with this caveat, if you, first of all, you have now, without any shift, compatibility between the inverse image for CR Chesh and the inverse image for the crystalline inverse image for CR Chesh and the CR Chesh of the D module inverse image. And again, if you make the non characteristic assumption on F dot, then you have preservation of D Chesh perfection. So now let's turn to the case of direct images. There is first a case where the notion of deperfect complex behaves well. This is the case of smooth morphism. In this case, you have commutation between the direct image of the crystalline direct image of CRX0 and the crystalline direct image of F+. Now, how do you prove this? This is basically because the two sides can be identified with derived cohomology. So if you have to do things a little carefully, you have to do some dévissage, but it basically amounts to this. And now, we deduce that the following. If you have a smooth morphism, EF0 is non-characteristic for a complex which is D perfect on X0, E dot, then its direct image will be D perfect on Y0 over S. So this essentially means that you have a morphism of schemes which is smooth, and you have a complex which has a support which is proper. So it's an improvement about the classical proper and smooth situation when you need the support to be proper. Now, if we'll finish with discussion about the behavior of Ditches perfect complexes with respect to direct images. So I need a general comparison theorem, which is the following. Suppose you have a proper morphism between smooth F schemes and a DBF, a complex which is in DBF perf of DX. Then, in the derived category of filter complex over OY0 over S, you have commutation between the crystal sphere functor and the direct image in the D-module sense. The direct sphere of the direct image in the D-module sense is the direct image in the crystalline site of sphere Cech. I forgot the beginning of the slide, sorry. I have to make an assumption because this uses duality. It's really a kind of relative duality theorem. So I use duality for crystalline cohomology. And for this, I need to assume that S is a quotient of a discrete valuation ring. It's much more limited for the time being. I don't think this notion, this condition should stay forever, by the way. I think I was just doing what I had to do to get to the Weyl cohomology for crystalline cohomology, but there's no reason why that shouldn't be duality theory, which would be a general relative duality theory if you only assume that S has a dualizing complex, for example. But for the time being, it's limited to that. Okay, so we have this relative duality theorem, and then we deduce from this that X0 are proper and smooth, and F0 is a morphism between X0 to Y0. Then the direct image of a Ditches perfect complex is always a Ditches perfect complex. So this includes both the case of closed immersion and the smooth maps, and actually the proof uses the Grass factorization to treat both cases. The first case follows from the fact that we have this commutation theorem, because for between CR X0 Cech and crystalline RF étoile RF lower star. And the case of smooth morphism requires more work. We need another duality theorem, which is a crystalline duality theorem, relative crystalline duality theorem. So assume that you have a proper and smooth morphism of smooth S0 schemes. First of all, there is a trace map from the direct image of our relative dualizing sheaf KX0 over S to OY0 over S, which on the trivial thickening Y0, on the trivial thickening Y0 is the usual Durham trace morphism, because this can be identified with Durham cohomology up to a shift and twist. And second thing, then, is defined for you a pairing between the direct image of a D-perfect complex E dot and the direct image of its dual to KX0 over S, and this pairing is a perfect pairing. So this now tells you that the direct image of the Ditches perfect complex E dot Cech is itself Ditches perfect because it's simply the dual of the direct image which we have seen earlier to be perfect, direct image of E by a smooth morphism. Okay, but so I think that's the end. Oh, I didn't use all my time. So I end by stating the results for cohomology itself, which is a formal consequence when you take Y0 to be spec of Wn of the previous statement. Okay, thank you.
Okay, so any question or comment?
So F upper shriek.
F upper shriek. You mean defining a crystalline F upper shriek? If you start with D-perfect complex, then you have the recipe, magical recipe, which consists in defining it as the dual on X, F over star, and the dual on Y. And this works. And you can define F lower shriek also, if you want, but if it's only going to be defined in the proper support, in the case of a proper map, by the same trick, and there is the adjunction formula between both. But it only tells you that you have F over shriek and F lower star are isomorphic in the proper sense, in the proper case. So it's not so great. But you can define F over shriek. It's a way to do it.
Okay, any other question? Okay, so if not, let's thank our speaker again.